Good evening, everybody. Thanks so much for tuning into this week's podcast. I'm really excited to have my good friend Jack Sutte on. Jack is second trumpet in the Cleveland Orchestra. Jack, it's awesome to have you on here.
Mark, thank you so much.
So, and Jack, I've always enjoyed hearing you play and play in the section and your solo recordings. There's so much to unpack with everything you bring to the table. I wonder if you might start talking about your early time as a player, like how you came to the trumpet and music.
Well, I didn't start on the trumpet. I was actually, my parents had us involved with a lot of different arts. For me, it started with violin. In fifth grade, I started the trumpet, which is a normal starting time for bands in Wisconsin. I studied the Suzuki violin method on the violin through high school, and also did some dancing like ballet and tap. Some jazz. I don't do the dancing anymore, but I think it's good that people know that, you know, while I do play the trumpet, that many, many times there's also other arts involved with growing up. And yes, I had to wear a dance belt, and yes, I had the shoes, and yes, I wore tights, and I kind of enjoyed it. Although I just remember the positions now.
So you grew up in Wisconsin, and when did you start taking trumpet lessons?
Well, that's an interesting story, because I was one of those students where I couldn't find a teacher at first. We reached out to the Milwaukee Symphony folks, and Dennis Najum guided us to Dr. Pat Backus, who was my first like real private teacher. Although I have to say, I had great band directors too, who got me off on the right start, and just great music in the program in Oconomowoc. So I'm thankful for that. But Pat Backus took me on as a student, and we remain in good contact to this day. And I'm very thankful for her teaching and getting me on the right path.
And I'm going to kind of go back to what you said about your band programs. What do you think made that so solid and got you off on the right foot?
I think there was always the guiding principle of the art, or a collective art of beautiful music. And the directors really strived. I was thinking about this after you asked me to be a part of this, like, where do you start mentioning all the fantastic teachers that one has had? And so, you know, starting with Dwayne Block and Tanya B and Dave Royal, and even my retired neighbor, Rudy Timmel, Rick Grothaus, Mr. Hofer, Rob Franzblau, Michael Peterson, and you know, it's just like Marjorie Deutsch, Mr. Dixon, all these great, and part of the Milwaukee Youth Symphony Orchestra was also very, very important to me.
Yeah. And was there a lot of did you grow up around a lot of music in the house, or was that something you had to import a little bit?
No, we had music going all the time in the house. Both my parents were music educators. My father's now passed, but he was a high school teacher My mom taught K through eight in a small like country school district. So music was always going in the house. We were always practicing. We were not allowed outside to play unless we had gotten our violin practice. And then when the trumpet came along, it was trumpet. And then even through high school, there was a little bit of piano, but I dare say that that getting the two hands to work together on the keyboard was just crazy.
Yeah.
That's a tricky thing. And I really am. I'm really fond of the sound world of the piano, especially with the trumpet these days, but we'll get to that later. But yeah, music was always going. And I'm thankful that my parents had the radio and the records and all that going. Yeah.
I was trying to time our answer to let this fire truck pass outside my window. Were there any recordings that stick out on the trumpet that really drew you in as a kid? Because I think we're both the same age, so we probably have similar vintages.
Yeah, trumpet recordings. I love the early Håkan recordings. The Bisch Scarlatti variations, his concertos with the piccolo trumpet. Those are really impressive. And then Winton's recording of like the Tomasi and the Jolie. It's just like, you know, oh, really good. So, and then classical recordings, some records that, you know, there's a Prokofiev classical symphony that I just listen to all the time. And it was a Shostakovich 5 with Previn that I just listen to all the time.
Oh, the CSA recording of that.
Probably. I don't remember. Yeah. I can picture the cover.
Yeah.
Then, you know, as I got older and my bandwidth got wider, as far as like who I wanted to listen to, there's no shortage of great playing and great orchestras.
Yeah. Well, so what kind of things, and this, we're still talking about your young period, what kind of things were you practicing in high school?
High school for me was irons, Lipsler's, some Clark, Charlier, and a lot of solos. I think that would be most of it. Transposition, of course.
Yeah.
But that was more of Pat and I got started on that. But I think we went into more depth with Mr. Katarabic doing the saxa and so many keys.
Yeah, that was the next question. If you talk about Mr. Katarabic and his influence on you and what studying with him was like.
Oh, I, you know, over this pandemic time or the COVID time, as I like to call it, I've really taken a gathering of my influences. And as a student, I was always kind of on a path, you know, where am I going? And it's not until I'm, you know, middle age now that I can really sit back and be like, okay, where exactly have I, you know, did I come from? Not Wisconsin necessarily, but just like aesthetically with the instrument and teaching and the kind of the genealogy or the tree of trumpet teachers that have come before me. And so I've spent some great conversations with Mr. Katarabic on the phone, staying in touch with him and just making sure that if I had a question that came up that I maybe thought about when I was in school that I ask him now. So,
yeah.
It's been a really, it's been a dire time for a lot of musicians and, but also some space to do some new things. And, in addition to asking questions and looking for information and reading and learning new method books, if you will, it's been a good time to keep that headspace open.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and when you were at Curtis, I believe you had some other really good colleagues there. I believe you and Kevin Cobb were in school together.
Kevin. Right? Yeah. And, Paul Jeffrey, Jason Gamer, James Shaw, and before me, it was a really great time. I enjoyed it thoroughly. I liked being in school. I liked being in the sound of the orchestra. It's just, it was all good. And Mr. Katarabic was tough. He was a tough study. And one of the things that he always impressed upon me and some of the other students was to always keep the singing sound. It it can be big. It's just got to be beautiful. So, yeah. I think that's one of the greatest lessons, that if you're making a beautiful sound, and you're singing, that you're more likely to have someone want to listen.
That's absolutely. You mentioned Soxa with him. I've always heard he was really big into Soxa.
Yeah, I think it was part of, as I've learned from his training too, the Charlier, the Soxa, the, you know, the Clark, the transposition, the solos, and of course, some excerpts. But that wasn't our primary study. I think the overall course of study with him, and certainly with Ray, was more etude and solo driven, so that then the excerpts are easy. It works. I think a excerpt driven teaching is a little boring from my perspective, and I think the students can stagnate a little bit because they're more worried about learning 10 seconds of music instead of developing like the confidence, the efficiency, the endurance, the range, the power, the strength, that you need all those things to play the excerpts, but you can get them in different means. I don't know if I answered your question, but I may have.
No, I think you did, because you're talking about what they focus more on. So,
oh yeah. So Soxa. Yeah. So Mr. Kataravic would like oftentimes chuckle as he assigned me, you know, the on B flat trumpet in E and F, and then on C trumpet in E and E flat, so that you're getting all the tritones and minor, and they're probably, it's just sharp keyed etude.
Yeah.
Now I don't know if I could do that today, but it was good training then. And what stands to your point, Mark, what stands out was a comment that Ray made to me, my teacher at Juilliard. He's like, you know, like the transposition thing is like, you know, it's good that you're working on it, because I'm paraphrasing.
Yeah.
Because my teacher transposed better than I did, and I'm probably a little better transpositioner than you, and downhill it goes, right? So I think keeping these skills alive, even as the parts tend to either B flat or C trumpet, knowing how to maneuver that is critical, especially in the big romantic music that's always changing.
Yeah,
the trumpet.
And it's great for your ears too, because you're hearing completely differently than the person that just looks at it all the time, right?
So yeah.
Yeah. So then you went to Juilliard and you studied with Ray Mace and some with Chris Kecker. Can you talk about studying with those guys? I mean, they're obviously great friends of ours, but
yeah. I love my studies with both of those gentlemen. And I have to say, being part of the ABQ seminar was also very impressionable for me, working with Chris and Rojak and Powell. And it just was, the program was great. And it kind of instilled in me my love of one, modern music, and two, chamber music. And so, you know, 7 or 8 years ago now with the Brass Trio, I was able to kind of get my fill for that professionally and aesthetically, of something I always desired. So while it may not be five, it's three, and I'll take the three anytime. Rick and Jesse are awesome. So yeah. Thanks, guys, if you're listening, thank you.
Well, yeah, and I'm definitely going to get into the Factory Seconds thing, because that's a, or we could talk about it. Well, we can talk about it now, maybe, because.
Well, let me just go back to the aesthetic with Ray and with Chris.
Yeah.
And I can say I'm so thankful for having them help me polish my playing. And some of the stuff that I still work on today, refinement of articulation, again, purity of sound, not just like that big singing power that I think I was pretty good at coming out of school. But you know, learning how to play that mezzo forte small ball game has been in the orchestra, chamber music solos. You don't have to blow the walls down all the time to make the point. And it's just so great, to have had that, you know, that window open and to be like, oh, this is also possible. So, thanks Ray. Thanks Chris. That's great.
Yeah, they're such great guys, and like also so logical and well thought out with the way they approach things, and you know, and encouraging also.
Oh, absolutely. And you know, beautifully so, the carrot was just always like, it's just out of reach, you know. It's so good.
Yeah,
really good.
And I don't know anybody that had better articulation than Quintet than those two guys.
Beautiful. Yeah, I loved listening to him play. And, you know, now with Kevin, I love listening. As groups change, right? Orchestra players change and chamber music players change. And what they're doing for the genre is awesome.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, I should ask you this too. Out of those ABQ recordings, I mean, I know I have my standouts. Were there things that you just went back to time and time again, even now, that you'd love to check out?
Yeah, yes and no. I think the early music stuff is really quite, the Renaissance album in particular, I think is really cool. The back and forth trumpet.
Fire and Lightning, yeah. Oh,
so good. And I like the big pieces that they've done, like the Roarum and the, I'm forgetting the name, Locking Horns. I'm drawing a blank on names of pieces. That's just the way my brain works.
Yeah, they definitely covered everything. I mean, the full spectrum of quintet repertoire.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Totally. It's.
Yeah. Yeah. So after you left Juilliard, then is that when you went straight into the job in Norway?
Yeah, I freelanced for a little bit my last year and for a few months after. Working, the connections from Chris and Ray were immeasurably helpful, and thank you. Ray was able to help me get in contact with the people in Bergen through Aspen and Per Hanevold, and arranged for a trial week, which was really interesting to play an audition and play the repertoire for the week. And so my audition was like, I don't know, Czech 4, Mahler 5, something, something, something. And then the week was Alpine Symphony and something else. And there's a tape of that floating around somewhere. I have to find it, but it's it was pretty good back then. I don't know if I could do that today, but I was very, it went well. And of consequence, I was awarded the position. And then right before I left, the Cleveland job was open, and I was successful at that audition too. And so thank you, Michael. Thank you, Christoph, for that audition. And the strangest part of working in an orchestra is oftentimes when you're leaving an orchestra, right?
Right.
In the time at the Bergen Philharmonic, my first day of work, I had to go into the personnel office and be like, I'm leaving, because that's how close in proximity those auditions happen. And this is something that can happen with players when they're younger, like I was, you know, who were able to, you know, kind of put a string of win of auditions together at the same time. We see that, I think, historically through the ages.
Yeah.
It's just interesting. Part of I guess being in the right spot, right place at the right time. So it was an awesome time. There's a great orchestra, the Grieg Hallen's a beautiful space, the people are wonderful. I loved living there. I loved being in the Europe, playing in a new music ensemble and doing some freelance work. It was a wonderful half a year for me. And again, kept my mind open. You know, it was like, it's like this pandemic time has really taught me that I really don't know a whole lot. I mean, I think I know what I like and I can do some things pretty well. But when you go down to the drawing board and you're just like in the shed, you know, like it's really humbling. And keeping that open space, I mentioned it again, is like learning different methods, I think, has been really helpful. And it reminds me of the time when I was, that's why I came back to it. It reminds me of the time when I was younger and still learning all the repertoire, and, you know, that space of the brain is just open.
What was the, can you describe the Cleveland audition? Because obviously you're in an iconic orchestra, and I'm sure stepping into Severance is really something the first time for that audition.
Yeah, it's, there's a funny story at the end of it, but let's go to the first part of it. Let's see, where do I start? So I didn't get accepted to the audition, the first round of resumes, and Cleveland really screens heavy. So I think my resume was in the B pile, and they had Jeff Hardcastle was on a 1-year position at the time, and they had another audition coming up, and I think some auditions had come and go, and then it got down to the B pile, and there was like, I think 5 or 10 of us that were invited to come. And flying in, my valve got, my B flat valve got banged up. So I'm playing, most of the excerpts are going pretty well. I think the sight reading was bom, bom, ba, 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 the Mahler 3 thing. The first time I played the last C sharp, second time I played it better. My solo, if I remember right, was Ketting Entrada, which was my solo of choice, which I think is a real, I still do. I think it's a beautiful choice of solo. It gets you up and down the horn and plays strong and fanfare and lyrically. I remember playing the 2 trumpet excerpt rounds with Michael. Mm-hmm. But even before that, the wounded B flat was catastrophic. And so I had to borrow Michael's horn for the audition. Thank you, Michael. So that's another thing with like instruments and things. From that, I think, moment on, and even maybe even before, I am not really tied to instruments. I mean, I like certain instruments, but I like the mental space and agility that one can pick up an instrument and make it work, right? So now some work better with an individual than others, that's for sure. And I certainly have my preferences, but being flexible as that day has been really great. Not only with picking up different instruments in the orchestra setting, but also for chamber music. Yeah. In the trio, I play a whole slew of different instruments for different pieces and, you know, different colors. I don't think really anything of it. So
yeah.
Yeah. Pick the, you know, if you can pick the trumpet that really suits your ear for the piece. And, you know, as collections go over the years, I know trumpet players like to collect trumpets. I do. I have a small collection and I like to play them, you know, yeah. So.
Well, did you play a lot of B flat trumpet on that audition, or?
I think I played a mix. In the 2 trumpet stuff, I tried it at first and it wasn't great. And then I went back to the C trumpet and it was better.
Yeah.
It's a skill that I think I'm way better at now than I was, you know, those 20 years ago. But I have to thank again my teachers growing up, because I grew up playing the B flat trumpet in band, in circus bands. I know how it works. I'm not afraid of it.
Yeah.
And you got to be able to play it. Like the masters from the 20s and 30s and 40s, and they put these etude books together, which are crazy hard, right?
Yeah.
They knew what they were doing on the B flat trumpet. And so I think if we can take a step back and get into some of those manuals, it'll really help fine tune your playing. That's what I've been doing.
Yeah, I was going to ask, like, what would you say your percentage of practice is between B flat and the other ones? Is it mostly B flat?
Oh yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Like 80-20 maybe. I'll use the C trumpet for like etudes and repertoire, but I don't do a whole lot of basics, because I believe that they transfer. If you're doing everything right, then it's just a slight transfer of, I think it's harder to go down. I think it's easier to go up for me.
Yeah, I agree. So you got the job and you've been there since, what, 1999 now?
99, yeah. January of 99, the new year. It was great. The first week was, you know, playing in an orchestra like that is like, it's the first week I'm remembering back. Sorry, my delay there. It was like a recording, and I you know, it sounds silly to say that, but it was like really, really fantastic. And I think that week was Miraculous Mandarin and Schubert Great, Schubert 9. So
nice,
right into it. It was awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. And I mean, yeah, you've been there for a while now, and you've gone through a couple different music directors, of course. And what memory do you have? Any we were talking before about, are there any concerts? You said there's some concerts that really stick out in your mind that were particularly special.
Well, they're all special, Mark.
Of course.
We did a Schmidt Seven Veils with Franz. That was really cool. We've done some contemporary pieces that were memorable because they were so hard. I remember, forget the composer, but Core, it was like screaming high, crazy piccolo trumpets. And then the next piece was Brahms Requiem. So we're all like, you know, trying to get something going again. But those were memorable for different reasons. I think aesthetically, the Miraculous Mandarin and Bluebeard's Castle we did with some dancers and ballet setting was crazy. I wish I would have been in the audience for that. Yeah. And you know, with CVD and Yakya, there were some great shows. There's so many to choose from.
Has there been anything that's ever stuck out? This may be a weird question, but for like comedic value or something like odd happening that you can talk about?
Yeah, I'll use one of my things. So there was one time that we were doing this comparative meteorology piece by, I think it's Johannes Maria Stout. And it's so vivid because Lyle and I were playing cornets with bucket mutes. And my bucket mute flips off the bell and does a little roll. That's funny. I've lost a slide out of a rotary trumpet once. I think we were doing, might have been Mendelssohn IV Italian. It just kind of like it popped out, and you know, what do you do? I mean, just so yeah, accidents happen. The scary thing is always the harmon mute going out the bell, right? You don't want that to happen, but you know, I've had that happen too.
Yeah, that's why they're dented. We've all had it happen.
Yes, that's true. So the flubs, and you know, there's countless flubs. I probably have a ledger 10 reams of paper long, but so I can't remember any like exciting like moments where the squirrel ran out the bell and it was like on fire and it was just terrible. But
that's sure like a good story if you're going to make that up.
I know, but unfortunately, I think the bucket mute is the best one because it just is so like. It's just the whole thing is should never have happened.
But it's a bucket mute. So in a cornet, I mean, who thinks that's going to stay in? You know. So you know, can you talk a bit about what's your daily practice like?
So I think for a long time I was doing a lot of Schlossberg, and that again was passed on to me from Frank and Ray. And over the years, I've been experimenting with different things. I am a player who likes to do a lot of different practice every day. I try to rotate things so I don't ever get stale. And so, well, in my mind, so I don't get stale, and so that my ears are always being trained to do something else.
Yeah.
So I've been practicing recently a lot of Thibaud and the pedal tones and the double pedal tones. My goal is to get to a double high C. I'm seamlessly right in the method books. It's a challenge. I think I'm at F and G now. So the pandemic progress has been plentiful.
Yeah.
Triple alliteration.
Yeah.
And I'd still do a lot of Clark. I've been trying to work through some of the Vacchiano books, which I find are interesting. Spalding, I've been doing that. Aaron Harris, again, some of these early 20th century method books. And some Arnold Jacobs things, which transfer great to the trumpet.
Yeah.
Sometimes I follow my nose. I mean, I don't need a method book to really practice double tonguing or intervals. You know, I just kind of wrap my mind around, you know, major intervals, minor intervals.
Yeah.
Major scales, minor scales. So I do a lot of, I've been doing a lot of that. And the thing that I really like about the Thibaud idea is, or at least, because I don't know him, I never met him, but what I gather from the books is that, again, there's like this supple dolce Francana. I've been practicing a lot of this, that type of playing, I think, is really effective for getting things to feel like they're coming together and moving forward without having to play so loud to get things going. So that's what I've been studying a lot of recently, a lot of up and down the horn.
Now, when you say you do things for a bit and move on, is some of that transfer from Ray's ideas about like his 10-week practice guide, where you would do something for a week or 10 days and then rotate it through? Or is it to kind of go a couple of days at a time, or do you have a regiment of it all?
No, I just kind of follow my nose. Like I, if I need to work on something, I'll work on it. And if it's not working, I'll pull it out and do it. I'm not a regimented player every day.
Yeah.
And it kind of goes to like my aesthetic on the horns. Like yeah. I'll pick up a different horn every day and try to make it go. So, so that the feeling is always slightly different and I'm, adaptive.
Because
my work is adaptive. I have to be adaptive. It doesn't pay for me to get stuck into what I really want to do all the time, because then I'm not adaptive.
Right.
So I just try to keep my mind open, especially now as I'm getting, you know, again, middle aged, and I got to practice more than I did when I was younger. I mean, that's just a matter of fact. So that's what I'm doing.
And kind of talking about some of the aesthetics that you like and that are you do a lot. When did you start composing?
Oh, about 5 or 7 years ago. It's about the same time where I stepped back a lot from my athletics that I was doing. And I got the itch to like learn again. And I started talking to some friends about maybe going to school for business or for composition, or just trying to do something that was different. We've had some colleagues in the orchestra who have done that type of thing. And there's room for that if you want to put the time into it. Unfortunately, my children were younger at that time and I needed to be more hands on deck. So it wasn't really viable as an option. But I did start sketching. I continued to sketch from college. I had a sketchbook and I finally gathered the strength and the muster to put some notes down that were my own.
Yeah.
And it's a daunting task to try to get out what you hear. My first pieces were obviously for trumpet because it's a instrument I know, and I've written a fair amount. And then I've written a few pieces for trio. I've done a ton of arranging for the trio, which we're hoping to get published in the next year, including our upcoming Christmas CD, which is going to be very exciting and very fun. So keep an eye out for that. Then some pieces for a big piece for trumpet and piano. I have a band piece that has 4 movements that's in sketches. But really right now it's been arranging for the trio and trying to get that, the music together for that. Oh, my point with, I just remembered with the Thibault was that he takes all these different vocalises, whether it's Sabarish or his own or Stamp or whatever, and he puts it into a way that's all common ground. It's not like you're doing one thing in light of the other or keeping one thing out and doing it. So I think that's why I've really been drawn to it.
Well, that was Oh, I'm sorry. I'm going back to the composition thought.
Yeah, please. Sorry, I digressed.
No. It was fine. I was thinking, what was it like the first time you played one of your pieces in public? Because that's really like
a vulnerable thing, right? It's a drag. It's a wonderful, harrowing life experience. I'll have to send it. I can put it. I'll have to send it to you. There's this chanting that I wrote.
Yeah.
For the 4-valve B flat trumpet, which goes low and really high. It's a piece that I recorded at the beginning of the pandemic, as well as the other chanting, which is on really low on 4-valve flugelhorn. But that, in addition to that piece, that's the solo part of it, then goes into a larger section with percussion and organ and double bass, and it's kind of atmospheric and meditative. Yeah, it's a challenge. It's a mental challenge because you're being, you're putting the pressure on yourself for being judged for your playing and your music at that point.
So it's a double-edged
sword. Of course, you know, we're our own worst critics always, and the pressure is always heavier, closer to your own head and shoulders. But I find it very important as a musician, as an artist. I shouldn't call myself an artist, of trying to be an artist, right? It's a strange label to put on oneself, but I think it's important if you have some music in you to write it, because no one's going to get it out except you.
Right.
No one's going to do it. So you might as well do it yourself and see what happens. See if you like it. You might be really good at it and you might write some awesome tunes. And now the software's great. So I use Sibelius. It's took a little bit of learning to do, but I like it.
Yeah.
And I'm going to keep doing it. So
when you listen to your pieces, do you find yourself saying, oh, I see myself streaming toward this composer or that composer or this style or that style?
That's an interesting question. I don't know. I listen a lot, but I try not to, unless I'm arranging, I try not to do a lot of parody.
Right.
I try to do my own tunes. Like if you listen to like the Bent CD, when I have the few pieces there that I wrote for my family, they're all slightly different. Mm-hmm. They're kind of, I guess, caricatures, if you will. But they're all kind of different.
Yeah.
So I don't know if I'd, that's a good question. I would have to say I would let someone else, like a theorist, try to figure that out.
Right. Form follows function, right? So that's a good way to do it.
Sure.
Talk about a little bit. So let's go to the trio a little bit. Talk about how things kind of happened with Rick and Jesse and how the group formed and there's some other questions I have about it, but just kind of talk about the formation of it.
Yeah, absolutely. So it's like one of those things that guys are going to get together and read some trios, right? And Rick approached me and he's like, well, we should do some trios. And so like, okay, we got to get Jesse because it's all of us. And then, you know, Rick is very witty and came up with our name, Factory Seconds, which I think is very fitting. Yeah. And Jesse was total game for a gamer for doing the trios. And we were like, what are we going to do? Poulenc, you know? Yeah. We just started reading. We enjoyed the time together. Mm-hmm. We enjoyed the camaraderie. We enjoyed the laughs. We enjoy having a pot of coffee together. I think we've learned that we can be in a car together. No one's going to kill each other. We can road trip together. So I think aesthetically as a group, it's easygoing. We rely on our strengths. And it just works. So, yeah. As I said earlier, it's just, I'm very thankful for that. For the guys who want to play and put that much lip into an endeavor, because trio is not easy. Right.
Yeah.
So that I'm very thankful for.
So talk about the repertoire for the trio, because obviously it's not as deep as the quintet repertoire, but there is quite a bit out there. I wonder if you could talk about the repertoire, and then are there any things in your playing that you noticed that you might have to change a little bit versus playing the quintet, because there's so much more endurance involved with the trumpet, and because the trombone and horn all of a sudden have such a broader sound than the way the trumpet mm-hmm. plays, and how you have to fit into that mold a little bit.
Yeah, so that's I'll start with the repertoire. So as we started digging, there's probably not as broad of trio repertoire as there is quintet, but there is a lot. And as soon as you start going a little bit deeper into the mid-century and earlier kind of 30s and 40s European stuff, especially the mid-century things here in the States, and through the 70s and 80s, you got to dig a little bit and see what the group sounds good with. Like, what does the group identify with?
Mm-hmm.
which we've done a lot of reading, and we've done a lot of just reading rehearsals where we just find the score. But there's more than you would think. And again, you just have to find the aesthetically pleasing stuff. So that's pleasing to your group. Whether that's long pieces or short pieces or miniatures or however it goes, but there's a slew. So we have a small repertoire list of some of the more contemporary things we've done by modern composers up on our website, factoryseconds.org. But I think it's one of those things, like with any group, you should just kind of follow your nose. Or, you know, if someone wants to get in touch with me, that, you know, you're welcome to write me and get a sense of what you're looking for. I could help point to some directions.
Would you say there are pieces like we all know the Poulenc Trio, and I think that, like, you when you said that, it resonates because we all kind of think that's okay, this is the trio piece. And are there other pieces that you would say should really stand out like that, that are very accessible and it should be kind of a more of a common?
Yeah, I don't know if the Poulenc is accessible. It's, the joke is in our group, it's that's where the trumpet players, it's the graveyard of trumpet players, right?
It is.
That's where they go to die. They play the Poulenc. So
yeah.
To your point, you got to find that the other question with like endurance and repertoire, and you got to find the horns that work. So we started off playing our orchestra horns in the trio because that's just what we had. And over the years, I've collected a lot of Schottky and Selmer trumpets that I've been using primarily in the group. They blend down a little bit better. I think it's been a good thing to experiment with. And I encourage anybody in a trio or a quintet to do that, to try to, instead of trying to blend up to the trumpets, to try to blend down to the lower instruments, as you mentioned. I use cornets and flugelhorns and my four valve a lot in the bass clef. So having those instruments was really helpful. In addition to D and E flat and other trumpets, so that you pick up a different horn and it's a different color, so it's not so monochromatic. I think with three voices, that's the key, is keeping it fresh for the listener, because you can get kind of burned out with all one sound. It's like the voice can get, you know, both louder and softer, and if you're listening to a singer, they have lots of different tonal change-ups, and I think it's hard to do on one instrument. I think the listener will gravitate more to more colors. Yeah. As far as like repertoire for trio, just to name, I'll just try to do five that I think are awesome pieces. I think everyone should know the Frackenpole Trio, quintessentially American beautiful music. As soon as you learn that one, I highly recommend the Leslie Bassett Trio. We recorded those two pieces recently. I think they're fantastic. And the Bassett's a little bit challenging because it looks weird on the page and it doesn't sound like anything. But if you spend the time shaping the lines, it really comes alive. I think the Plogue Trio is awesome. Both aesthetically and as an exercise in playing, I think it's great music. Mm-hmm. And then two, actually, I'll mention three pieces. There's the, Nigo Benson, Benson Trio, which is odd, but very, very good and effective. Kind of that the Dutch kind of.
Yeah.
The Jean Louel Trio is also very good. And the René Manier Trio is also really interesting. I think I'm thinking of the second one. And again, when you start, these are things that I like the aesthetic of. I also like the way, you know, we were talking earlier about the ABQ and the early music. I like three voice early music. It's beautiful. And you can play all sorts of different instruments. The key doesn't matter, so you can pair it. But
yeah,
I think looking for composers, that's one of the things that we're doing now, is that we have some interesting commissions coming up in the next couple of years, as well as some really interesting projects. So yeah, it's fascinating. There's no shortage of trio music. You just got to dig.
You just gotta dig. That's very cool. And you were also talking about you're doing some arranging. Have you arranged some early music for the group? And
yes, quite a bit.
Yeah.
Yeah. And again, we're on the precipice of getting all of this music out in our publishing efforts, which is me. And I haven't been as good as I should, so it's delayed.
Hard to do everything.
Delinquent? No, we all take a share in the group. It's just this, that's the one.
Well, I didn't mean that. I just meant it's hard to do everything in your life.
Oh!
I didn't mean that. I just meant like, it's hard to wake up and go to bed and get everything done that you want to do.
Yeah, well, let alone the bucket list, right? So right. I need another pandemic for the bucket list stuff. At least the things I can get done in my house, you know? But it's never ending. You are correct.
Yeah. But that's very cool. And you guys have done a lot of stuff too. I mean, you've been playing, you play formal concerts, play in bars, you've played a lot of different venues. I think the trio is a cool thing because it's kind of more mobile and there's a lot of things you can do with it depending on who you're playing for and what you're playing for.
It's portable. And we did some outdoor concerts at the beginning of COVID. We did them before, but we also did them during. We rehearsed throughout COVID, distanced, with great success. It was actually a really great way to keep us in the game, you know, not in addition to teaching, right? Mm-hmm. But also playing, finding people to work with, even, you know, I guess it could have been slightly dangerous, right? But we were spaced out.
Yeah.
We took it seriously. We had no issue.
Yeah.
So if you follow protocols, it is possible. Yeah. And we did. And so I think I'm thankful for that time with them because it really helped keep the efforts going towards getting back to work.
Yeah. Well, and then let's talk a little bit about your recording because this is, I mean, prior to what we're going to talk about with the Sonata Palooza, which I think is a brilliant name, especially when you talk to me about how many sonatas there are. But you did the Fanfare Alone, Beyond the Moon, and Bent, and all of those records have, Fanfare Alone is all unaccompanied music.
Yeah.
Right? And then, so you and Kevin must have flipped a coin to see who had the better unaccompanied music title. One.
I think his is awesome.
I think they're both great. I mean, and Beyond the Moon is really beautiful. I mean, I have my copy of it here. And
oh, thank you.
Oh man, I've always, yeah, no, I love the piece. And the fact that also one of the pieces on that recording that I'm surprised isn't played more is that Vern Reynolds Sonata.
Yeah, we just got, for the Sonata Palooza, we just got done recording that again with Christine. So it was really interesting to come back at it and to learn it with a different pianist.
Yeah.
But as far as the solo things, you know, it's like, I forget how many years ago that was now, 2013, eight years ago or so, I wanted to do something different.
Yeah.
And, you know, Kevin was certainly, he's a very inspiring, someone I've always admired his playing. And, I value his work. And, so I wanted to do something slightly different with that and put like more of it out. Right. And so, that the Fanfare Alone and then Bent is a follow-up to that. And I recorded another one at the beginning of the pandemic. It's going to be called Litany of Breath, which is going to feature David Sampson's, that's going to be the title track. So for those of you out there, it's a really neat piece.
Yeah.
Where was I going? So all of that, what I've learned in doing recordings is that CDs are great, but they're like coffins, unfortunately, in this day and age. And if your music and your information is not in some type of HTML format that Google can find, it's really challenging. So Fanfare Alone, for example, I wanted those pieces and the composer's music to stand on its own.
Yeah.
And after a few conversations with some people I respect, and I went back and did program notes for those pieces over the pandemic, and to try to and I got my website up finally, which has all of that information now on Fanfare Alone and all the pieces, and you can reach out to the composers from my website. All of that's interconnected now and searchable on the Google. So I'm still going to make some CDs because I like records, you know. Yeah. I like having something tangible. Yeah. But if you listen to those pieces on Spotify or Pandora or Apple Music or Amazon or whatever it is that you have access to, and you're wondering about those pieces, go to my website and search. The PDFs are up there. You can link to the composers and get their music. It's all accessible. And that's the goal of, that was always my goal of doing these projects in the first place, is like being a vehicle for the composers and getting new music out there, which is really important to me.
Yeah.
And same thing for Bent, like that, all that information is up on the website. So.
And the hands of recording of Bent, by the way, is particularly great. I love your interpretation of that. I mean, that's a piece that's recorded a lot. So, you know, when you stick it out there, it really stands out.
Well, thank you. It's, you know, it's one of those dangerous pieces that we tackle at different times in our life. And that was one of the pieces that my teacher at the time, in high school, I started working on the first movement. So it was like, you know, Tomasi and the start of the Jolove and the Henza and difficult music like that was things that I was starting to decipher. And yeah. So it was like unfinished business to try to figure out the other movements. And I think the first movement might be the hardest. The other thing that I wanted to do with the canzone was to do it with a different mute than a harmonic mute. I hear a lot of players use that as a go-to. And I'm not sure that's the right color. What I used was an old leather mute that Frank gave me that I wrapped with a leather cloth so that I could, it would have enough to blow into, and yeah. You could maneuver it with a grip. So you have like a leather wrap ball around the end.
Yeah.
And that's what I used in that. So again, it's like an aesthetic thing. If the harmon mute pleases you, that's awesome. But for me, it was always like the wrong muted texture in the sonic sound. So, but thank you.
Yeah. Thanks. Yeah. I mean, actually, before we get into the Sonata Palooza stuff, I wanted, and cause you brought up the Henza. I love, cause as long as I've known you, you've played a lot of solo recitals, cause we've known each other for 20 years now. And it seems like every time I was in Cleveland, you were getting ready for a recital like all the time. So you've learned a lot of music in addition to the orchestra stuff and the trio music and all the solo repertoire. Can you talk about your process for learning? Because it's got to be, you have to be one of the most efficient music learners of any trumpet player I've ever known, as much as you've done. So, I mean, I'm kind of curious about what your process is.
Oh, that's an interesting, I never thought of it like in a scope thing. It just, it keeps me busy, right?
Yeah.
I like learning a lot of music. I've always been, my teachers were always doing a lot of music with me and making sure that I was going through repertoire. Yeah. And I think the amount, and I think from my earlier training with violin and piano and singing, and I think I sight read pretty well. If I don't keep it up, I lose it, right? It's a skill that but I always try to sight read all the time. So to that point of learning new music, if I'm always learning new music, I'm always sight reading, right? So that's, I think, part and parcel with that. And again, it keeps my mind open. I don't know how to try to say this, but to be the best player I can be, it's not just to do my job
right.
at the orchestra and just to do the second trumpet parts. I think if I were just to do that, I would not be good for myself and for my job. So I think to keep expanding my playing and my mind with challenging, like really, really challenging things that you wouldn't see, that's been of benefit. So I think to your point, I think I push myself that way. I like the challenge. I like the endurance part of that. I like trying to put programs together that are like challenging for me as a player, not just something that I can get through, but like, how am I going to get through this? Like, what's the puzzle part of it?
Yeah.
And I think part of that stems from my, when I was exercising a lot, doing the duathlons and time trialing and running races, that there's a certain amount of the endurance aesthetic that I really enjoy. So,
and speaking to that endurance aesthetic, would you say most of what you're working on for the endurance is actually the repertoire itself, or is there anything you do away from the music, like Caruso or some kind of Maggio, some sort of strength building that you find gives you the extra gas that you need, or is it mostly working on the pieces?
I don't know the Caruso or the Maggio methods. Yeah. I know there's more like holding. I don't even want to speak to it because I don't know it, but I know of them. I just haven't practiced them.
Remind me of listening, playing the pieces, I would imagine.
I think the strength for me comes from like trying to be efficient with just getting up and down the horn.
Yeah.
And, you know, making sure you're resting enough in your playing, so in your practice, so that you're, you know, at least equal time played off. I think that's a real benefit, and that takes time. I think a lot of students these days are, you know, just kind of rushed for time or for this or that. But I mean, if you set your clock for a few minutes and play, or just like even if you play eight counts of stuff, something, and then rest eight counts, or 10 to 10 or whatever it is, I think that the balance, that type of practice was always, you know, I think instilled in me.
Yeah.
When I'm getting ready for recitals, though, I'll practice like what I would call threshold work, where I'm going for broke, and it takes it, you know, you got to recover. You know, I don't do that every day, but yeah. When I'm getting ready to do my big projects, I am pushing my endurance. And then of course, getting it back and going small and playing soft and delicate, and that's the key.
Well, speaking of pushing the limits, so let's talk about Sonata Palooza then, because first of all, the first recording, I've listened to it. I know it's in on the way in the mail, but I love all the pieces, especially the third sonata, which I didn't know, by the Czech composer. So let's talk about, first of all, tell people what the whole project is and how many sonatas you're thinking about laying down. It's
again, it's like the endurance thing, right? So oftentimes more is less, but I think here more is more. And I'm really excited to do this for my playing as I'm getting older. I'm looking at the next 10 to 15 years of like honestly, and trying to do really important things that I want to do. Mm-hmm. And so this was one of them. And I found an awesome collaborative partner with this, and Christine Fuoco at BW. She's awesome, and she's been willing to take the time to learn the scores and really learn them. I think a lot of the pieces that I've learned maybe superficially in school, it was nice to come back to them and really get down to brass tacks. So the goal, and what if you go to my website, you can read all about it. But the idea was to take the sonata abends, like which violin players and piano players do, and try to do that for trumpet. The first 12 we played and recorded, we tried to do. I'm gonna try to. It's on my website, but we did them. The first three. On the 9th of January, the second three on the 12th, the second three on the 13th, and then the second three on the 19th. And so this was a few years ago now, but we tried to space them out just enough as we could in the hall. It was basically, I think we would have done them back to back to back, but we couldn't line them up to do that type of thing at the school. So we had to space them out a little bit.
Wow.
We recorded live and did a patch after. And that's a harrowing expedition for all that repertoire. And so I think that what I've learned is that we're not going to do that again. We're going to do like just regular type of studio work where you go in and set up a recording session and do them. that's a little more feasible and a little more relaxed than trying to get all the notes. And it's.
Well, it sounds great. I mean, the first recording is Canon, yeah, Pills, and then this Yuri Mittner. Where did you find the Mittner piece?
I found the Mittner at a store in Vienna while I was walking around on tour. And again, it goes to that idea of like always reading new music. I like going through music. So this one was in a pile. And so I reached out to him. It was the US premiere. And his publisher had to get it up on Harry Fox for us to, you know, do the mechanicals and all that other stuff.
Right.
But we've been in touch. And I think he's getting ready to publish a trumpet duet, a really fine composer. And I hope to meet him in person, you know, after all this is done. But I'm thankful for the work. He has a recording with a Czech trumpet player up on his website, which again, you can get to from my website. So, it'll be up there. So you just got to poke around on the Sonata page. But the goal is to learn 12 every year. So we did in those first concerts, and it's again, I'll do a list, but Canon Pills, Mittner, Hindemith, Harold Shapiro, Eric E. Wazen, Floor Paters, Halsey Stevens, George Antile, Jean Hubeau, David Loeb, who wrote the sonata for me, and the Leo Sowerby, which is an awesome piece in large score form, sonata form. It's a burner.
Yeah. Man. And you said how many sonatas are we talking about?
I don't know how many we'll get to, but we have the next 12 kind of up on the plate. We're starting, we're recording the second 12 this summer, and we'll start learning and getting to the next 12 over this next year, and hopefully start recording the next 12 next summer. So
it's just a phenomenal thing you're doing, because there's going to be so many reference copies of some of these new pieces, and we won't play the same four or five.
So everyone knows, like, you know, the Hindemith and the Canon and the Halsey Stevens, and certainly the Awazen, right? It's like probably the most played sonata. The Jean Hubeau is beautiful. But after that, and the Antile is known, if you can, you know, it's a hard piece. It's one of those burners. But after that, you got to start digging and be like, you know, do I really want to learn the, you know, the Paul Holmes sonata, which is also a great piece. That's on this next one. Terry Everson's been doing some great sonata work too. Not only his older recording with the Söderberg, but what's this next one? I forget the composer's name.
He has a whole collection of these out.
Yeah, he does great work too. So they're out there. You just got to be willing to spend the time to do it, and, you know, to dig a little bit. Yeah. So
where would you say? I mean, like the Mittner came from a place in Vienna that you just kind of found. Are some of them kind of pieced together like that? Or does that turn into something where you have to dig a little bit and do some research on the internet? Or have people brought things to you, suggestions? Or?
I was lucky that we have a really great library there. And some of the pieces that we found are actually out of print. So, which happens with music, like this Leo Sowerby piece. We're also having some sonatas written for us. Daijuan A wrote us one that we're going to be getting ready to play. She's what's she doing? Her graduate studies at IU. Fantastic piece. So, it's a lot of fun. And again, it just goes to like keeping me busy and keeping my chops in good shape.
Well, it's amazing. And so, you know, the website will be up here on this interview a couple of times so people can reference it and go check them out. The discussion we were having before about CDs versus MP3s and the effects on that. I mean, I know maybe we're old timers and we like CDs and records more. Talk to the point about maybe what students or people that are listening to some of these things for the first time, they're not quite getting the context of the piece. Maybe they need more about the composer or where it comes from, and what CDs provide. I mean, what do you, how do you talk to your students about that aspect of listening and context?
Historical context or composer context. Yeah. So there's always a backstory to the pieces, right? And as time goes and composers are becoming more distant memories if they've passed, especially those who weren't in this digital age, it's harder to find stuff on them. Like my notes for the Henze we talked about, I read some of his stuff. I put my own thoughts together. I was trying to find some meaningful writing at the time and books, and I think you have to kind of piece together the story at the time, like the zeitgeist of the time when the piece was written. So for my students, I'm always asking, like, okay, what you know, what's the deal with this guy who wrote this trumpet etude, or woman who wrote this awesome new piece, or whomever. I think it's important that you craft your own notes, and again, not just kind of recycle someone else's stuff, that you think about it enough to have some critical merit in the game.
Yeah.
So it's not just a 7-second TikTok flashpoint, you know, that it's, you know, it's going to take a little bit of study, and it might not be online. I mean, I've done research on Wikipedia. It's great. I've gone to the library and pulled out books, trying to find information like on Floor Peters and, you know, stuff that he wrote about, or other pieces that he wrote at the same time as his trumpet sonata. And you just got to kind of put it together. It's just, you got to follow your nose. It's kind of like finding repertoire. You just have to have a knack or inspiration to follow your own inspiration.
Yeah.
Because again, no one's going to, you know, that the easy way out is just to go pirate someone else's stuff. And bring your voice. It's like, why do you play the trumpet? It's like, there's something commanding that you like about it, or subtle, or sweet, or whatever word you want to put towards the instrument. But the same thing goes for your energy towards a project, or critical thinking. It's just, it's the same.
And I guess the last of the project I want to talk about are the etudes you've been working on with Nathan Ott.
Oh yeah. That's fun really to do.
Yeah.
So again, it's the same for me. And I really appreciated Nathan finding me. We hadn't met. I hadn't known him. It was kind of like a cold call. Would you be interested in doing this? And I was like, absolutely. And so my buddy Chris Clark and I did some, and my colleague here in Cleveland, who's doing all the sonata projects, Bruce Gigax, we did some recordings in his studio in Cleveland. But again, it's like keeping the fingers going, seeing as many different notes for me aesthetically as I can, and just trying to stay on top of my game.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, they're really great, and people should check those out too. So I mean, it's like,
I enjoyed those projects, and I think I mentioned it on my CD or somewhere in his book that, you know, I put titles to all of them, my own titles. And I think he references that some of them, but yeah. I think it's whatever it's, if it's number one or number two etude, to learn it to a point where you actually have a thought on the aesthetic that you're trying to create musically and put a title to it. My Rick Stout and the trio always puts words to pieces. And that can also be a fun thing to do, but at least start with a title, right?
Right, right, right.
I hope Nathan continues to write etudes, and I think they're challenging. Some of them are repetitive for a good reason, to make sure that you're staying in balance with the horn and execution. But again, it's like, for me, it's a great way to just keep learning, and to not be so it's like you're only as good as your last note, right? So it's like part of that aesthetic for me is like, you know, I gotta keep learning, I gotta keep chugging in a good way, right? So that I can keep my career as long as possible.
Well, that's one thing that's come out during this, I think, the pandemic. I mean, like guys like Jim Wilt that were recording in like an etude every hour, so it seemed. You know, like there's a lot of great trumpet music that's just kind of sits in books that we've ignored. And I think now you're doing the same thing with the Sonata Palooza. So between that and the trio stuff and the arranging and the composing, I mean, it's just a tremendous service.
Well, that's the, yeah, well, thank you. And it's a joy to be doing, you know, something different. And if there's something different that you want to do on the instrument or with a group of friends, you should do it, because again, and I've mentioned this before, no one's going to do it for you. And yeah, what Jim's doing and Chris Smith and other players who are, have taken on these etudes that have been taught forever and ever, and there's no, again, there's no reference for students to learn. I think it's a great great service to our larger community.
I should say Jack Burke, because he might be watching, because he's recorded a ton of these things.
Awesome.
About guys that have been doing them.
Awesome. Yes. Yeah. So, for me, I like the things that I like to do, and I don't see myself doing more etude work. I see myself doing more like chamber music and chamber aesthetic things. Yeah. That's not to say that I may not start to do some, but I got my plate full. Oh, I remember my point. So this is all the artistic stuff, but this is not the real life stuff. So
yeah,
I got to do the laundry. I got to take out the trash. I got to walk the dogs. I got to, you know, do house repairs and all that other real stuff. It's, you know, like, this isn't just, as my wife and I like to joke, it's not just we're sitting around and, you know, eating bonbons and doing, you know, dreaming up these, you know, fantastic artistic projects. I mean, we all have lives in addition to doing this trumpet stuff. And so while it may seem like it's an inordinate amount of time, if you collectively look at the minute widgets and you have a half an hour here or an hour there, and you're really effective with your time management, there's lots of time to do things, as I found. So that's the way I can contribute to what I'm doing, as I may not be able to sit down for 2 or 3 hours and do what I want to do, because like, Rosie, come here. So my dog was just here. So when you have that, oh, there you are, here, come say hello to everybody. When you have that impetus, see, there's always something going on here. When you have the impetus for that creative moment, you should seize it if you can. And then if you can't get to it right away, save that space and remember what it was like to have that inspiration and come back to it. Try to get back into it.
Yeah. Well, Jack, thanks so much for doing this. It's such a pleasure. I mean, you do so many things, and you know, I hope people will check out your recordings and check out Factory Seconds and then the publications when they come around, because I have a feeling we'll be playing more trios sometimes than quintets, is the economics of things we're on. So that's a nice service too.
Yeah, it's great. And Mark, thank you so much. And for your dedication to doing these talks, I'm happy to be a part of them. And yeah. You're doing a great service for our trumpet community and the world. And I thank you for that. And thank the sponsors as well. So thank you.
Yeah, thank you to Dylan Music. I mean, thank you to Guard Bags this week and Euclid IQ very much for their financial support with these. And Jack's great to see you. And I think I'll see you hopefully in person soon.
Sounds good.